What happens if you throw a cell phone into space? Well, that's what this guy did.
No, you can't just throw the phone in space, even though we did throw a phone in space. It's a little bit more complicated than that.
Why do this? Because making satellites more affordable, like consumer electronics, means you can make a lot of them. And if you can make a lot of them, you can put them into space and capture the entire Earth every day.
We have a database of how the Earth is evolving at every XY coordinate of the planet at every time going back 5 years. Being able to see the entire Earth every single day and how it's evolving, it is a new capability for humanity. It's never been possible before.
Google figured out how to index what's on the internet and make it searchable. We are essentially figuring out how to index what's on the Earth and make it searchable.
If we allow 8 billion smart people to understand how the Earth is evolving, what could we do then?
This is Hard Reset, a series about rebuilding our world from scratch. I've spent so much time imagining what it would be like to work at NASA that I've never thought about why someone would quit. But that's exactly what these guys did.
When we were at NASA, we were actually thinking, well, a smartphone has radios, processors, rate gyros even for games, GPS to know where it is, significant processing power, all in this little box. Many of those capabilities, in fact, there's about 90% overlap, is exactly what you need on a satellite.
The initial idea was to make small, affordable satellites that had a short lifespan by design. Instead of one super big satellite that stays in orbit forever, they could constantly be upgrading and replacing those small satellites as the technology improved.
Moore's law means that our ability to process, to store, doubles every 18 months. Historically, satellites have not kept up with Moore's law because you build one of them and it has to be amazing and perfect because it costs you $800 million. Planet was the first one that said, well, what if we instead build lots of small satellites?
The miniaturization of electronics is enabling us to do what we call agile aerospace, rapidly iterate the satellite capability in orbit on a much more frequent basis. And every time that uses a slightly better sensor, you know, we go from a 29 megapixel sensor to a 47 megapixel sensor. We went from four spectral bands, four color bands on the spectra to 8 color bands. Our next generation satellite produces 5 to 10 times more data per day per satellite for the same cost as the previous one. That trend has led to about a 1,000-fold increase in data produced per dollar spent on the satellites.
Traditional maps mark a moment in time. But by taking photos of the world every day, Planet's maps show us more than what the world looks like. They show us how it's changing.
What we see from our bird's eye view, daily scanning of the planet, is immense change. Rivers move, forests get deforested, agricultural fields get harvested, houses get built, roads get built, vehicles move. Everything is changing. And so this perception of the world is static is completely wrong. It's a fundamental engineering principle that you have to measure something faster than the timescale of change to do something about it. Otherwise, we can't do anything about it. We can't fix that. We can't stop the deforestation if we measure it every year, if deforestation happens on days and weeks. We can actually see deforestation before even one tree goes down. We can see the illegal logging roads that come in just before deforestation happens and help stop that just before that happens. Last year, we did the first map of all the world's coral reefs. But every day, we visit those and see if there's any signs of ocean bleaching or illegal fishing vessels in marine protected areas, and then alert the Coast Guard. Governments use the data to ensure that they can rapidly respond to disasters like floods, fires, earthquakes. We also help governments with monitoring security. So just last week, we exposed over 100 new nuclear missile silos being built in Western China.
And this cuts both ways. Just as governments use this data, so can citizens. Individuals can access the same data about what their governments are doing, which means it's hard to hide those concentration camps.
BuzzFeed won the Pulitzer Prize from using planet data to uncover areas where China, for example, was building forced labor camps. So I actually think that transparency creates security, creates trust, and that's true between businesses and people and governments. It's also true between nations.
The early days of the internet were, well, they were awful.
The truth is, I wasn't entirely happy.
You were connected to a massive amount of information, but unless you knew where to look or what IP address or URL to connect to, how could you use it? Search engines like Google and Yahoo are what made it possible for normal humans to use all that data. They cataloged the internet and made it searchable. So what happens when you catalog the Earth like this? That's the big idea with Planet. With image recognition, they can identify what's a house, or a container ship, or a moo cow. They're building a searchable index of the entire world.
We have a data set that images the whole planet every day. And in principle, with computer vision, we can abstract out objects. Then we basically build up a database of all the objects on the Earth over time. And that database should be queryable. You should be able to just say, well, how many roads are there in Pakistan? How many trees are there in the Amazon? Just tell me where the illegal deforestation is in the Amazon over the last month.
Take agriculture as an example. You can create an index that tells you an immense amount about what's happening in your fields, and not just at the scale of a single field, at the scale of every single field across the entire Earth at the same time, every single day. The more that we can build machine learning tools on top of it that allow people to extract just the parts that they care about, the more they're going to be able to solve problems we're not even thinking about today.
So what problems could we solve with everyone able to see what's happening everywhere in the world every single day? In the same way it was impossible to predict all the ramifications of the internet, it's hard to imagine the ideas and companies that will be created because of this technology. But could the most important thing that comes out of this be a reset of our perception of the world, to give everyone the same feeling that was captured on December 7th, 1972?
I've always remembered that iconic shot, the blue marble. Every single person who ever lived, lived on that little blue dot captured from millions of miles away. We have a single spaceship Earth, and we have to keep it safe.
It was astronauts going to the moon, looking back at the Earth and going, whew, that is one fragile planet in the vastness of space.
That single image changed how we thought about our planet. But we won't have just one image anymore. We'll have billions.
You can't understand your own country without visiting other countries to get some sort of perspective. So it's not surprising that we have to go out to look back and take an understanding of our planet and see how it's changing from a distance that we can get perspective. The most meaningful things for me personally are how this helps us to take care of our ecosystem. In the last 40 years, we've lost 70% of life on the Earth. The wiping out of biodiversity is a tragedy. I think that our grandchildren will look back at this time and be flabbergasted that we were trying to take care of the planet without regular information about the planet. I mean, how were we going to, you know, transition to a sustainable economy? How were we going to stop emissions if we didn't measure it? We might see in the future predictive analytics that start going, okay, well, where's the urban sprawl going to continue? Where's the deforestation most likely to happen next? Which coral reefs are most likely to get hurt next? In agriculture, how do I predict the crop yield at the beginning of the crop growing season?
This gives everyone the opportunity to become cartographers and explorers of our world in entirely new ways.
People can see the rivers move. They can see the new nuclear missile silos. They can see the Uyghur detention camps. That means that you can't have a sort of bystander effect as much, right? You can't just sit and ignore that. You can see it.
Come back next time for another episode of Hard Reset. Subscribe to Freethink to watch our other original series and documentaries about technology and people that are changing our world.